Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the WDSU Hot Seat. I'm Fletcher Mackel in tonight for Norman Robinson. Earlier this week, details surfaced about a potential labor deal between NFL owners and players, which could end the current lockout. What was revealed was the framework of a potential labor deal that could get the NFL back on track. Representatives from all 32 NFL teams met in the Chicago area to discuss the details about ending the work stoppage. Owner executive Rita Benson LeBlanc and team CFO Dennis Lauscher represented the Saints. In the latest proposal, owners would no longer take $1 billion of the $9 billion profit off the top for expenses. Players would receive 48% of all revenue. A rookie pay scale would be part of a new deal. Players would need to play four seasons in the NFL before becoming unrestricted free agents, and there would be improved health benefits for NFL retirees.
I think the objective here is to get something that works for everybody. It's not what everybody wants. It's what everybody needs to reach an agreement that is fair and balanced and is going to work to make our game better and to continue to grow our game.
Joined now by Gabe Feldman, director of the sports law program at Tulane Law School. Thanks again for joining us. We haven't seen you since the fall.
Thanks for having me back on.
All right, let's just jump right into it. It seems like progress was made and this lockout could be ending maybe in the next few weeks. Is that fair to say? Or are you optimistic?
Very optimistic. I think we've done a 180 from where we were about a month ago. Remember, the sides a month ago were litigating. They were suing each other. And now they're finally talking, not only talking, but making progress. And it looks like they're close enough that within a couple of weeks, they could have the parameters of a deal. And maybe within a month, they could have a signed deal that gets us back to football.
You have been on, it seems like, every national show, NFL Network. You've been quoted in every national publication. You've followed this very closely. Who wins in this? If a deal does get done, let's go under the assumption a deal does get done. Who wins in this? Does anybody lose in this? I can't imagine anybody loses, given the fact that you're cutting up $9 billion. But who is the big winner, if anyone, or are both sides winners?
Yeah, I think you hit the nail on the head. When you're splitting up $9.5 billion of profitable business, both sides are winning. The only way there was a loser is if they somehow missed some of the regular season games and lost part of that $9.5 billion. So right now they're both winners, and they both got something out of this deal. Remember, the current situation was the players got about 50% of total revenue. They wanted to maintain that. The owners wanted to take some back, give the players maybe 42%. Well, now it looks like the players are going to get about 48% of the revenue. But total revenue, so as revenue continues to increase, the players maintain some share of that, lower than they were getting before, but they're not giving away $1 billion or $1.5 billion off the top.
Can you talk a little bit about, I guess, maybe some of the more talking points of this deal when something like this gets done? Obviously, we look at the big picture, but you're a guy who's been in negotiations like this before. You work for the New Jersey Nets. How many I's have to be dotted and T's have to be crossed in something like this?
How many I's are there? I mean, there are thousands of I's to be dotted because this is a incredibly long, complex document, the collective bargaining agreement. And we think for the last few weeks they've been ironing out some of the details because there are a lot of issues other than the revenue split. The revenue split was driving this. Without a deal there, we weren't going to get a deal on the overall CBA. But you've got issues dealing with 18-game versus 16-game season. You've got the rookie cap. You've got disciplinary conduct. Disciplined by the commissioner, who gets to control that. So you get a lot of issues in a 300-plus page document that have to be dealt with. It's going to take a long time to get all that finalized, but once we get that revenue split ironed out, the rest will fall into place.
Is there anything that could potentially derail this at this point? Demora Smith, the union chief, I don't want to call him the union chief because there technically is no union, but he's the representative of the players. He said earlier this week that a lot of this is false hope. Is he maybe going out on a limb saying something like that? When he says something like that, I don't think he's trying to derail the process, but what does he mean when he comes out when things are going so well and he says something like that?
I think he's just tempering expectations. I think it's a smart thing to do to not get anyone's hopes up too much. And it really doesn't matter. We've learned what they say in public. What only matters is what they're doing behind closed doors. And it does appear from all accounts that they're making progress. And you ask what could derail it. Well, there could be some dissension among the players. You have a lot of people you have to get to agree on this thing. There could be some dissension among the owners. Either side might feel that they're giving up too much. But from what we hear right now, there is consensus among the two sides enough to get this deal done.
Can you just talk a little bit about, I guess, how important it is to get something like this done? Because the numbers that came out to me were staggering. If the NFL continues to grow like they expect, and like we heard Roger Goodell say in that soundbite, their profits could be $18 billion in 5 years by 2016. Had they not got this deal done, they were talking about losing billions of dollars because of the TV money and the cancellation of games. Is that just a staggering number when you hear pro football profit $18 billion.
Yeah, and when we look at total revenues, you say $18 billion, you say, how can that possibly be? But you look at their television deals alone, give them $4 billion a year. And now they're talking about adding a new 16-game package on Thursday night, which they'll put out in the open market. That could fetch close to another $1 billion a year. So it's not that hard to see this growing to $16, $18, $20 billion business annually down the road. And when you think about that, then you realize this is why a deal got done before they risk losing some of those regular season games, because if you lose regular season games, sponsors aren't going to pay, TV networks aren't going to pay, fans aren't going
to
pay.
All right, quickly before we go to break, when we come back from break, we're going to talk about the NBA, because the NBA has a labor battle they're about to fight, and it could get ugly. Let's do a couple of quick rapid-fire questions here. Does this deal get done in the NFL next week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, or 1 month?
I say yes. It gets done between 1 week and 4 months. Excuse me, 1 week and a month. I think we're probably going to get, again, that broad framework of a deal within 1 to 2.5 weeks, and then a signed contract, I'd say, somewhere in the middle of mid to late July.
Do all the games become, I guess, come to fruition this year? Do they lose any preseason games, or do we have 4 preseason games and all 16 regular season games?
I think we get a full slate of preseason and regular season games.
Is there anything, in your opinion, that could derail it at this point, or a big nugget that could derail it?
I don't think so. I think we're on the road to a deal. You never know. There's still a lot of moving parts to this, but at this point, I think it's going to be fairly smooth sailing.
All right. Gabe Feldman, Tulane University. When we come back from the break, we're going to talk about the NBA's labor situation. And again, the picture not as pretty as it may be right now for the NFL. Stay with us, everyone.